Good evening. Please take a seat. We're about to get started. Welcome. My name is Sebastian Burke. I'm the Director of Corporate Programs at the Council. We're delighted to welcome Professor Glenn Hubbard with us tonight. I'd also like to take a moment to thank our sponsor, Zurich, for their continued support of this very important series, program series. Please know that this event is on the record. Feel free to use social media, but please silence your phones. And the video recording of the event will be available soon online. I'd like to highlight a few upcoming programs at the Council. We have a lot of them, but these are just a few. Tomorrow we have Ambassador Hussein Haqqani, former Pakistan ambassador to the US, on the current situation in Pakistan. And then in the evening, we have Dan Byman speaking on the global jihadist movement. On November 11th, we have our senior advisor, Raj Shah, on the food price volatility issue in the global environment. And then on November 12th, we're really excited about hosting Garry Kasparov on Putin's grand strategy. So that should be a really interesting program. I'll rejoin the stage for Q&A, to moderate the Q&A, but now I'd like to invite to the stage to welcome our speaker, Mr. Will Trumbull. He's the Chief of Staff to the Chairman of North America of Zurich Insurance Group.
Thank you, Sebastian, appreciate it. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Zurich and the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, I'd like to welcome you to this final program of our 2015 Global Economy series of events. Zurich is very pleased to support this important ongoing series of the Chicago Council. Our organizations together recognize the need to lead on discussions on the increased opportunities, increased severity, frequency, and amplification of risks throughout the global economy. This fall, we were delighted to host Ms. Gillian Tett, who spoke on the benefits and the drawbacks of specialization in the global economy. And of course, former Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke, in conversation with Martin Wolf on the global financial crisis itself. Tonight, we are delighted to welcome back to Chicago Professor Glenn Hubbard to discuss his perspectives on the current state of the future prospects for U.S. economic growth. As you all know, economists tend to disagree on why U.S. economic growth has slowed. Some argue that relatively low growth rates are the new normal, while others suggest that macroeconomic policies can make a significant difference. Professor Hubbard, as he'll confirm for us and discuss at length later this evening, believes that American growth can go faster if a combination of domestic and foreign policy initiatives related to taxation, regulatory reform, and free trade policies, among others, are taken forth by the powers of be. We're very fortunate to have Professor Hubbard with us this evening, and we look forward to his insights on these incredibly relevant issues. So now let me briefly introduce him to you. Professor Hubbard is currently the Dean of the Columbia Business School and the Russell L. Carson Professor of Finance and Economics. He is also the visiting scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. In government, Professor Hubbard served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of the U.S. Treasury Department for Tax Policy and Chairman of the U.S. Council on Economic Advisors under President George W. Bush. He also chaired the Economic Policy Committee for the OECD. He began his teaching career here in the Chicagoland area at Northwestern University before moving to Columbia to serve as Senior Vice Dean of the Business School and Co-Director of the Entrepreneurship Program. Professor Hubbard has authored several books, as well as many scholarly articles, and his commentaries frequently appear in Business Week, the Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, among other very notable news media outlets. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Glenn Hubbard.
Thank you very much for that, that very kind introduction. I am indeed going to talk about economic growth tonight. I know when there's an economist in the room, everybody wants to talk about forecasts, what's about to happen next. And I have to tell you that George Bush once said about me that Glenn can't even predict the past. And I think what he meant by that was the data get revised, or at least that's the way I heard it. So I'm going to do something more familiar for economists, particularly academics like myself, and really focus on the long term. But truly, it is the question facing the nation. And unfortunately, we're not talking about it. I put a piece in Politico this morning where I opened with an old joke that we're only talking about the 1950s. Republicans want to go back and live there, and Democrats want to go back and work there. Well, neither one is on offer. And what we need to be thinking about is the 2050s for ourselves, our children, and our grandchildren, and not the 1950s. We can't go back there, and I would argue we shouldn't want to go back there. In case you doze off, I'll give you the punchline in advance. I am quite optimistic about America's growth prospects, but they are not manna from heaven, and they do require substantial change from the current policy agenda. So to motivate that, I'm going to reach for three sources of wisdom that perhaps are not part of the familiar economic lexicon. The first is the Grateful Dead. The second is my former colleague in the Bush administration, Don Rumsfeld. And the third is QE, by which I don't mean quantitative easing, although I will talk about that. I actually mean the Queen of England. So let me start out with the Grateful Dead. What a long, strange trip it's been. There's no way to talk about the prospects for future growth without confronting squarely the elephant in the room of the long, strange trip that the economy took through the financial crisis. You know, what the financial crisis and its weak recovery laid bare was a problem in a very frequent story that Milton Friedman would tell. Friedman famously talked about business cycles as being most akin to plucking a string. So if you pluck a string hard, the give is hard. If you pluck it lightly, the give is lightly. And Friedman's intuition, which was actually spot on for most post-war business cycles, was that when you have deep downturns, you have sharp upturns. And when you have shallow downturns, you have shallow upturns. And that was more or less right until we hit the crisis. Now, one reason for that is the origins of this crisis look more like pre-war business cycles, not post-war. And in fact, if you really want to get in the weeds on it, it looks a bit like 19th century business cycles in which investment collapses and financial crises came to bear. The recovery from a financial crisis is slow. Finance is like plumbing. And I know when I speak to finance audiences, sometimes people get offended by this analogy, but try living without plumbing. If you disrupt the plumbing of the economy, the recovery is weaker. Having said that, we made it worse. Policy addressing the financial crisis, you'll go back and remember phrases like targeted, timely, and temporary, and off-the-shelf stimulus and business cycle responses, we're addressing a problem akin to what Friedman was talking about, but not akin to the shock the economy actually had. When the shock hit, it was necessary, and frankly, I'll argue with you tonight, it still is, to reset business people's expectations and to reset household expectations about what growth is possible. You do not do that with cash for clunkers. You have to do that with a fundamental change in policy that focuses first and foremost on growth, work, and opportunity. And those will be my messages for you. So the long, strange trip it's been, really, we're getting to this point of worry because we're still not quite sure why we've stumbled so badly out of the gate of the financial crisis. Part of it was baked in the cake, but I'll argue part of it was not. But that part is what leads to hope that we can fix it. Now, what about Don Rumsfeld? I don't mean here any military allusions. I'm not a foreign policy expert. What I mean is his famous categorization of events into known knowns, known unknowns, and unknown unknowns, famous Rumsfeldism. Now, known knowns are kind of easy to talk about because they're known and their effects are known if we know them, hence they are known knowns. And if we're thinking about those in global growth at the moment, I could think of headwind categories and tailwind categories. As a headwind, too, that I would put on the table, One is the situation in Europe of very slow growth. That too has a policy component, but that's a subject for another time, unless you want to ask me. China also has a slowing growth that is a known known. It's a risk not only in its direct effect, which is pretty modest actually for the United States, at least at the present time, but it does have a significant knock-on effect in emerging markets that have done a lot of commodity business with China, and they will affect the United States. I'm thinking here principally of large Latin American economies. So those are strong headwinds. But there are tailwinds. One that may not get enough attention is financial repair. In the aftermath of the crisis, we have seen enormous financial repair in the United States. Non-financial corporations are sitting on mountains of cash. What constrains any decision they make has nothing to do with financial weakness and everything to do with their own fears about the future, hence the need for a reset. And even American financial institutions that were wobbly going into the crisis have come out of the crisis much stronger, not only absolutely, but relative to their global peers. A second tailwind is energy. I still remember the event about a year and a half ago. I spoke to the Petroleum Club of Houston when oil was about $100 a barrel. And somebody just asked me a question. It was general talk in the economy. They said, what do you think the price of oil should be? I said, I don't know, somewhere in the mid-50s? And oh my God, the room just, who invited that kid? I think was the dominant thing. And I explained to the audience that, you know, I'm not in the energy business, but I do know supply and demand. And when you have a lot of new marginal supply coming up and weak global demand, $100 oil looked pretty fanciful. I still think high 50s is the equilibrium price of oil. We've gone lower than that, but I still think that's about right. If you are in the oil and gas business, or if you're in the large sectors that provide investment goods to the oil and gas business, that's a headwind. But for most of us and for most of the world, that is a significant tailwind. The delta from $100 oil to where we are now is the equivalent of a $1.7 trillion tax cut. And to the extent that you think it's long term, that is an enormous shot in the arm for consumption, transportation, and logistics, and also will ultimately affect the world real interest rate because oil producers tend to be high savers. So I think it's important to understand that it's not just headwinds facing us, there's some significant tailwinds. Now, what about the second category from Don of known unknowns? Now, they're unknown, but we kind of know where to look. So what are they? I would put a couple on your list. One is China. I'm going to put China in every category tonight, just so you know. But there is a known unknown. The known known of China is the slow growth. We can all see it. By the way, I don't agree with their statistics, but we can all observe what they claim the number is. Rather, in the known unknown, I'm worried about debt. So no emerging economy has had the kind of debt to GDP ratio that China has accumulated and had the story end well. It is very, very hard to navigate these levels of leverage. That is clearly a known unknown. The unknown known that I'm worried about in this country has to do with the Federal Reserve and the exit from the current stance of monetary policy. And I don't mean by that a technical concern. I know many people in the press and many politicians have expressed concerns about the size of the Fed's balance sheet. And while I agree that this is uncharted territory, I also agree with Ben Bernanke and Janet Yellen that they have tools to manage this. This is a technical problem. This is one that we know how to do. Rather, I'm worried about two other things. One known unknown to me is timing. Fed policy often gets it wrong at turning points. And I don't say this to insult a Fed chairman or any economist at the Fed. Very eminent economists who have run the Fed over years, including Arthur Burns, made spectacular policy errors in timing. And I have this worry that when I hear expressions like high pressure economy and wait till you see the whites of the eyes of inflation, that we have a timing mistake right around the corner. But I also have another known unknown problem for the Fed, and that's actually the underlying model. The Fed claims that it is using this multi-factor, 19-factor to be precise, model to guide it, the model has been predicting and is certainly predicting right now the need to normalize policy. And while the Fed says it's focused on the unemployment rate, I would remind you probably by the spring of next year, we'll be looking at an unemployment rate of 4.7 or 4.8%. The need for action is now. Rather, I think what's troubling me about the Fed, the reason I put it as a known unknown, is the view that monetary policy can raise the labor force participation rate. Now, it's a social problem in our country that the labor force participation rate fell as much as it did in the crisis. It's particularly a problem for young and middle-aged men. Having said that, it is not a problem the Federal Reserve can fix. There are abundant policy tools to deal with it. They don't live at 20th and C Street in Washington. Now, what about unknown unknowns? Now, your first thought ought to be, how the heck would he know? They're unknown, and we don't even know where to look for them. So with that in mind, I'm still going to mention a few that I would put in this category in unknown unknowns about global growth. One is easy for me to say, and I'll have nothing further to add because I'm not a foreign policy expert, but obviously geopolitical risks are the key unknown unknown. Stuff happens. But there are two others that I worry about that while they're unknown where they might show up, they're enough to put on our radar screen. One is shadow banking. During the financial crisis, we had gone through an experiment where we regulated very tightly one sector called banks, and we let some other sectors effectively do bank-like intermediation without the tax and regulatory structure applied to commercial banks. We had a shadow banking problem. We are doing it all over again. We've now doubled down and tightened further our regulation of banks, but have allowed pockets of run-prone contracts and risky short-term finance to build up elsewhere in the economy, and I think it's a worry. Then I come back to China. I told you I'd put China in every bucket. So the known known of China is the GDP growth. It's slow. The known unknown of China is the debt level. But the unknown unknown, the truly scary thing, has to do with the difference between the short term and the long term. So if you were to talk to, quote, serious people who look at the Chinese economy, they would say to you, well, the long term looks very risky indeed. China's sitting on a mountain of negative net present value investment. It has a financial system that is not fit for a modern economy. We, quote, know that. But people say, well, that's a problem that's way down the road because in the short term, things are fine. There are all these reserves and so on. The risk I want to put on your radar screen, and I call it an unknown unknown in this context, is sometimes in economics, actually often in economics, the border between the short term and the long term is harder to see than you think. You don't know. The long term can collapse to the short term very fast. Why do I think this? Xi Jinping tried to lean against the stock market decline in China. He failed. Everyone saw him fail. It calls to mind John D. Rockefeller Jr. going to the floor of the New York Stock Exchange after the crash and saying, "My father and I are buying common stocks," as if that would hold back the tide. Once it's apparent that the government really doesn't have the tools to deal with the new long term, I worry the long term goes to the short term pretty fast. Now to the Queen, because this is what I really want to talk about. What on earth did the Queen of England have to say about this? Well, now, I actually think she had the most interesting, the most thoughtful question about the entire financial crisis. Now, I know probably in your mind's eye, she doesn't look like an economist. Economists look like me, kind of like President Eisenhower. What the Queen, you know, she's got white gloves and a brooch and a hat and a handbag. I don't know what's in the handbag, maybe the speech she was going to give. But she came to the London School of Economics for one of her ribbon cuttings, and then she lowered the boom. The assembled groups were my colleagues, people I know well. They were the Department of Economics. And she asked them, why did nobody see it coming? And the room got really quiet. And no schadenfreude here. If the Queen came to Columbia with the same question, I'd be just as embarrassed by her question. Now, there are lots of answers to the Queen's question, but generally, when you don't see it's coming, it's something coming that's bad, it's because you don't really know where to look. And it means you're not asking the questions you should be asking. So if the Queen were talking to us tonight about questions for long-term growth, what would be the versions of her questions? And I have a few I would just mention to you. One has to do with the orientation of policy. We seem to believe, and I say we because it was true of both an outgoing Republican administration and an incoming Democratic administration, we seem to believe that the right orientation to getting ourselves back on track is to take a series of short-term steps, although the two parties may disagree on what those are, and then we get right back on the long-term trajectory. I would ask you to consider the possibility that that's exactly wrong, and we need to think about it the other way, that if we got the long-term problems right, if we realized that what ailed us going into the crisis and what ails us in thinking about growth are structural problems, if we fixed those, then maybe it's the short term that'll take care of itself. That, of course, is easier said than done. It is one thing for politicians to tackle short-term things, stimulus programs, things like that. It's another to tackle tax reform, regulatory reform, things that are hard, things where there are winners and losers, but that are absolutely essential for growth. But I would at least submit to you, that's one of the Queen's questions. The second question, and Will mentioned this in his introduction, is really how fast can we grow? You know, economists right now are really dour. I know most of you think that's always the case for economists, but there are optimistic and fun economists. But today's view almost calls into mind the 1930s, where economists had bought into the zeitgeist of the times to believe that growth prospects had shrunk. Now, a famous version of this is Alvin Hansen's words, secular stagnation. Now, Alvin Hansen was, in his day, a giant in the American economics community. He was, if anything, the John the Baptist bringing Keynes to the United States. His views on secular stagnation were that the economy would not be able to resume normal long-term growth without permanently larger government and government intervention. Now, this view had fallen out of favor for a while. In the late 1970s, when I was a student at Harvard, I bought in a remainder sale at Baker Library, which is Harvard Business School Library, Alvin Hansen's own copy of Keynes' General Theory with his notes and the word secular stagnation, and I paid 50 cents for it. My first seminar I gave at the University of Chicago, and I told this story to Bob Lucas, he said, "You overpaid." That was the view, but it's back. Larry Summers, an eminent Harvard economist today, has repopularized secular stagnation. I think it's very hard to make the argument that we're going to have chronically low demand. The story people usually tell is we're looking at very low levels of real interest rates, which must be telling us about weak demand. I don't agree with that. I think they're telling us about two other things. One is the hangover from the financial crisis. The other is the huge push in global regulation to increase the demand for safe assets. Banks, insurance companies, and others are hoarding liquid, safe assets so that the real interest rate you're seeing doesn't really look like what economists would call a marginal product of capital, but is something that's heavily distorted by regulation. Having said, I don't think there's a demand story. There is a concern here, and there's a reason people are scratching their heads and worrying, and it's really about the supply side of the economy. So when people talk about the supply side of GDP, and I can look at your faces and tell that economics was your favorite subject in college. So when people talk about the supply side of GDP, you'll remember they're talking about two things. One is inputs. So to be simple about it, let's say workers. And the other is the efficiency with which those inputs are used, productivity. Now, if you think about it from the current US perspective, there's a concern that the weak productivity growth that we're now seeing is permanent and that there is nothing we can do about it. And in terms of work and hours worked, pretty much the things that brought up hours worked in the past are viewed by skeptics as being over. For example, women entered the workforce. So that was a big change in hours worked, but you can only do that once, right? Women are working, but there's no new pool. We've seen a decline in male labor force participation rates, not only older men, but younger men, which again, I pointed out earlier, is truly a social problem. I think both of these trends are reversible. In productivity, we're already seeing good news of increased private R&D spending, which is heavily correlated with future productivity growth. And frankly, we don't know as an economics profession when productivity turns, but I think we do know of policy determinants for it, which would include things like business tax reform, regulatory reform, the discipline of trade and competition. We can do these things. On hours worked and labor force participation, we have unwittingly, and particularly in the past several years, created very high marginal tax rates on work, particularly for low income and people entering the middle income groups in our population. What's that about? Well, several things. It's the phase out of healthcare subsidies. It's the phased out of the earned income tax credit. It's the structure of marginal rates in the income tax. We don't realize that we're doing it. Nobody went into this saying, let's discourage work, but discourage work we're doing. Now, this is important in a discussion of secular stagnation because work is more than a paycheck. To rise up the economic ladder, you have to be on the ladder. People don't enter the ladder at the middle or the top. They work their way up. Either people of modest skills or people who've gone to college, wherever you started, you're getting on a ladder and you're climbing. The failure to deliver work not only lowers wages today, but it also lowers the future. So that second big Queen's question, can we grow faster? I actually think the answer is yes. Now, going back to where I began with the Grateful Dead, you know, another obvious question is, well, are we safe? You know, we had this financial crisis. And were these in our nation's capital claimed to have fixed it? We have the Dodd-Frank Act. We have international financial regulations. Are we safe? The short answer is no. I'll give you a longer answer. Financial crises are really about some combination of three things: runs, risk, and regulation. You can't have a financial crisis without a run. Now, I know some people talked about interconnectedness. You'll remember in the bailout of AIG, there was a worry about interconnectedness. There's almost no economic evidence of this. Rather, it was the more old-fashioned problem that's familiar in every financial crisis as far back as you can go, of contagion and a run. The best example I can think of in describing a run is a salad bar where you know that something is amiss. There's bacteria somewhere, you just don't know where it is. Your optimal response is not take a little bit less of everything. It's to take nothing, as Chipotle is now finding out for itself. The salad bar analogy and contagion mean that if you're going to go at a financial crisis, you have to stop runs. The second R word, risk, is important because financial crises typically involve the mispricing of risk. When we went into the last financial crisis, we had a lot of risk mispricing. Monetary policy had been too easy. We had low interest rates, we had low risk premia. That was a problem. And the third is regulation. Regulation can create, perhaps unwittingly, perverse incentives. So our housing finance model in the United States was a classic example of regulation systematically misallocating capital, not because anybody woke up and said, my job's to misallocate capital, but that's where the policy was. Now, think about what we did in Dodd-Frank. Dodd-Frank is very big. I don't know how many of you have looked at it, but it's thousands of pages long, and the regulations aren't even yet complete. But the thesis of Dodd-Frank's pretty simple. We need very complicated rules up front so that it'll never happen again, but then we'll deal with after the fact very simply with thou shalt nots. All right? So the thesis of Dodd-Frank is there are rules on everything, so now we'll never have a financial crisis. So now we can tell the Treasury and the Fed, no, you cannot intervene in the way you did before. Well, that's exactly wrong. If you really wanted to deal with a crisis, you need simple rules up front. To my mind, those would be things like leverage ratios, haircut regulation in short-term lending markets, and an absolute no too big to fail policy that's credible. In a capitalist economy, I don't care who you are, you're not too big to fail. And if we had those simple ex ante rules, ex post, I think we could say to the Treasury and the Fed, if we missed it, and by the way, we will, there will always be crises, no system is perfect, we want to make sure that whoever the Secretary of the Treasury is and whoever the Fed chair is have the tools to deal with it. And of course, Dodd-Frank did the other way around. So this was a real missed opportunity, and no, we are not safe, and in fact, we may be marginally less so. Final Queen's question I'll just mention has to do with fiscal policy. There's discussion every day about the Fed, and that's really unfortunate. The Fed has done what it can. I would argue the Fed has done too much in dealing with the present crisis. It has gone way beyond what a central bank should do. It has wandered directly into fiscal policy on multiple occasions. But I think the Fed can be forgiven for the temptation, and it's not unique to the Fed. It's true of the European Central Bank. It's true of the Bank of Japan. I think the reason for it is fiscal policy has been sitting on its hands. Better fiscal policy would not only have helped in the crisis, it would help right now. If we had tax reform, if we had entitlement reform, we would have the fiscal room to move in the near term to do something very big, very large infrastructure spending, very large investment incentives, freeing up the budget to have an economy looking for the future instead of its past would be very, very valuable. Let me close all this with some observations about growth and the election. We're already hearing words in the election that we need to get used to a new normal of slow growth. Don't you believe it? Don't you believe it? We don't have to grow at 2%. The difference between a 2% and a 3% economy is very large. If Jeb Bush were here, he might say 4%. But even 2% and 3%, that's a vast bid-ask spread. Think about it. Over one generation, one of those economies, the 3% economy, has already delivered more than 20% more stuff than the 2% economy. Over two generations, almost 50%. That is a really, really big deal. That's something worth talking about and fighting about. If we could pivot back toward that 3% growth, you'd see real interest rates come back to where they used to be. You would see much greater opportunities for work as well. We also are hearing in some quarters, frankly, in the Republican Party, absolute flim-flam. So there are some policy proposals that, if anything, and I'm thinking of Donald Trump here first and foremost, would actually reduce both the level and the rate of GDP growth. When we think about the election, there are many things that you worry about, and there are lots of attributes in judging a politician, but I would submit to you that the first question we ought to be asking is about growth. Many of you are business people, and whenever I speak to business people, I remind them, you have enormous power to influence change. People care what you think, where you are. Politicians care what you think. And helping politicians come back to this growth emphasis, I think, is very, very important. So let me wind up where I began. We can grow faster. And we can grow faster if we just think about the Grateful Dead, Don Rumsfeld, and the Queen of England, particularly the Queen of England and her questions. The things that are going to trip us up if we miss will be the questions that we didn't ask and should have. And I would just close with this observation, particularly apropos of a meeting like this. Conversations among business people, academics, and government people are all too rare on serious subjects of our day, and I think are growth promoting in and of themselves. So let me stop there, but I would be delighted to take your questions on that or anything I can talk about.
Thank you, Professor Hubbard. We'll take some questions now. We have microphones in the room, so please wait for my colleagues to bring a microphone to you. I will call on you and make sure, please, that your question is a question and not a comment. We have one in front.
What would you propose for long-term tax policy?
I think tax reform needs to start with business tax reform. And oftentimes people talk about that as corporate tax reform. More than half of Americans who work in the private sector work for an entity that's not a C corporation. So if we're gonna have business reform, the mantra ought to be bring down rates a lot and broaden the base. So to be specific, I think we could lower the corporate tax to 20% with a lot of base broadening. The Treasury would say that costs a lot more than I think. Why do I think it costs less? If we were at 20%, we would be well below the median in the OECD, and we'd see a lot more profits being located back in the United States. We'd see many business people repatriating funds back to the United States. And I think we could also eliminate the extra level of tax we charge corporations on repatriated funds, so-called territorial tax system. On the individual level, we need to bring down marginal rates. So if we keep dividend and capital gains taxes in place, a top marginal rate of 28% would roughly balance the corporate rate. And I think that all individual rates can come down to that level at the top. To pay for that, we'd have to do a lot of base broadening, as well as economic growth. An example of this is Governor Bush's tax plan, with which I have more than a passing familiarity. But I think any of these plans that bring down the rates and broaden the base are the right place to start. A good tax plan for today, though, needs more. It needs to think about work and opportunity. So if you go back to what I was talking about work, what do we need to fix in the tax code? Well, currently, the earned income tax credit that many conservatives love to talk about is a family support program. It's not a work program. We need to really increase the EITC's generosity for single people, for childless workers, and lengthen the phase out ranges so we don't have these very high marginal tax rates on work. Healthcare reform is important in that guise as well. And I think we should eliminate the payroll tax for seniors. It's ridiculous that we are people who want to keep working when they're above the Social Security retirement age are having to pay the payroll tax, but they're not getting extra benefits for that. So I think there are a lot of things we could be doing there in tax reform that are beyond the usual broaden the base, lower the rates.
We have a question over here. Please wait for the microphone, sir. Thank you.
Based upon what you said, should we have let Lehman Brothers fail?
You know, it's so hard. I'll tell you, I and probably lots of people were worried about Lehman Brothers before it failed. A lot of people had looked at Lehman. There have been a number of potential investors brought in. What troubles me about it is that we didn't seem to have a great plan, even though we had months go by from Bear Stearns to Lehman. I think when the Federal Reserve says, and with due respect to someone who was in my wedding and a lovely friend, Ben Bernanke, when he says that there was nothing we could do, I don't think that's true. I really don't. I think if the Fed and Treasury had wanted to, they could have done it. It would be Monday morning quarterbacking, which I don't want to do, to say whether yes or no, but they could have done it. I think even if Lehman, though, had been bailed out, I don't think we would have avoided a financial crisis because the pressures were still too big. But I think that quick fire might have been avoided.
We have a question over there in the middle.
Can you explain why in the last 20 years when we've had this extraordinary technology revolution, which seems to have made everything much more efficient, that productivity is slow, that productivity increases are slow? I can't understand this at all. Why isn't technology making us all incredibly productive, so productive that we're choking on it practically?
Well, the honest answer is I probably don't know, but I'll give it my best. Years ago, Bob Solo, who's a Nobel Prize winner in economics, said you can see productivity everywhere except the productivity statistics. And two things, Solo said that in 1987. We then had a measured acceleration in productivity in the 90s. It did show up. It took both time and changes in measurement. I think we are seeing enormous real changes in productivity. Our national accounts are built more for a steel and wheat economy than they are for a high-tech economy. When we think about the theory of price indexes, not to get too far in the weeds, it requires that we're making quality adjustments that we know we're not really making in technology. So I think two things are going on. One, with the fullness of time, we will see the productivity. And two, we may just not be measuring all that we are seeing. No business person with whom I speak anywhere has ever told me that they think they've gone as far as they can go in productivity. And certainly when you talk to people in the tech sector, there are amazing potential developments in productivity. So there may be concerns about the distribution of those gains and things like that, but that those gains will appear, I'm not too worried.
Thank you.
It may take us time to see them, but they will be there.
We have a question in the back. Amir, all the way in the back, please.
You know, closely held businesses are the backbone of the economy, and rates of entrepreneurship and new business openings, I guess, are down considerably. I know you can't legislate that, but what are your thoughts on that?
It's a huge problem. I'm glad you brought it up. Not just in the financial crisis, but actually several years before then, we had started seeing lower rates of business formation. And to the previous question about productivity, periods of more rapid business formation also tend to be higher productivity and more innovative periods. I think during the financial crisis, we made this worse with policy. I know that there's this view that interest rates are very low, so the cost of capital is low. Well, that's true if you're a cash-rich corporation. It's true if you're a wealthy person. But to entrepreneurs, credit is largely unavailable, almost at any price. So in this environment where the safe rate of interest is low, we scratch our heads, well, what about entrepreneurship? But we've told banks to get out of the business of commercial lending. We want banks to hold government bonds. So I think if we really think about the regulatory underpinning finance, we may have part of the solution. Now, part of it is also demography. Older people are less likely to start a new venture than a younger person, and we're an aging society, so I don't mean to suggest I have a silver bullet. But I think we need an entrepreneurship agenda that cuts across all these things. Thinks about it from a trade perspective, financial regulatory perspective, tax perspective, and so on. Too often we think about it only as a tax policy problem, and that is an element of it, but I think there's much more to the story.
We have a question over here, please.
What did you learn through the 2012 campaign that would inform you in advising candidates today to do a better job conveying your messages, conveying your solutions?
Well, they're only my messages if they fail. They're their messages if they succeed. That's one thing I've learned from years of advising presidents. Honestly, we need to be better communicators in the Republican Party about economic ideas. I think by and large, messages about growth and opportunity ring true to people, but they have to be said in straightforward ways. I think a candidate like Mitt Romney, who's an incredibly accomplished business person, an excellent executive, I've known him a long time personally, I think he would have made a great president, but clearly had communication issues. We're seeing that with some of our candidates today in the primary, so I don't have a silver bullet for it, other than the need to really boil things down to fairly simple economic themes, and to explain growth in human terms. You know, when I talk to audiences that aren't business people about growth, I never talk about GDP. I talk about what's going to happen to your wages after 5 years or 10 years at different growth rates. I talk about what's likely to happen to employment. You have to connect it to decisions people make. Same thing with entitlements. If you tell somebody the unfunded liabilities of Medicare are $28 trillion, that's true, but what's $28 trillion? But if you talk about what the path of taxes are going to be on a middle-income person to pay for that, oh, that's something you can relate to. So I think you really just have to think harder than many of our candidates seem to be doing.
We have a question over there.
Should we bring back Glass-Steagall?
I don't think so. I think there's a great work actually here in Chicago by Raghu Rajan, who's now the governor of the RBI, and Randy Krosner suggesting there probably wasn't a reason to do Glass-Steagall even in the first place. But certainly, if we'd had Glass-Steagall in the financial crisis, look at the resolutions that couldn't have happened. I mean, there couldn't have been a Bank of America Merrill Lynch deal. A lot of the deals that happened just weren't possible. I think what we've got to do is look through our system and say, do we have a lot of run-prone contracts? And we do. Maturity transformation in banking is the oldest problem in banking. And then the question is, what regulatory structure do you set up around it? Unfortunately, that's not the question we asked in Dodd-Frank. If it were, I think we'd have been better off. But Glass-Steagall is an old bottle. I wouldn't reach for it.
Paige, over here in front, please.
Thank you very much. I do appreciate your comments. Healthcare expenditures are about $2.7 trillion. 18% of GDP. When you talk about the aging population, advancement technology, and pharmaceuticals, what do you think would be the impact on the economy of the country? Well, thank you very much.
Long answer to your questions. I wrote a book a few years ago with two Stanford colleagues called Healthy, Wealthy, and Wise. That's the long form answer, but I'll give a short form answer tonight. Is 18% of GDP high or low? Well, normally in the economy, when we ask questions like that, we talk about value. You know, people in this room pay different amounts of money for whatever clothing you're wearing tonight, but I assume to each person, that was a valued purchase to you. Now, in healthcare, there's reason to be suspicious about value, because we don't, as consumers, see or pay the prices the way we do in the other 5/6 of the economy. So to me, one way of getting at better productivity and better outcomes in healthcare is to try to move toward a system that enables people to see more realistic pricing. So that's an argument about tax reform and an insurance reform. I also think we need much better information. You know, in most of the economy, you have pretty easily at your fingertips information about competition to provide you something. If you wanted to buy a mutual fund, you can find thousands of sellers of mutual funds. You can look up their performance, you can do everything. Yet in healthcare, something so simple as an MRI, I may have no notion what the dispersion of prices is and quality. So I think there's simple things that we could be doing. The right policy steps, it seems to me, are tax reform, insurance reform that would encourage the purchase of what economists mean by insurance, which is catastrophic insurance. Prepaid healthcare is not insurance, though it's not an insurable event. An insurable event is a catastrophe. So I think if we go that route, we'll be in better shape. There are no silver bullets. I can't promise you one, but I think people will start seeing more value. In a rich economy that's also aging, I think it's perfectly normal that we're going to see healthcare spending rise, even relatively. The question is just, are we getting value? Currently, we're not at the margin, but we really are on average. I was born in 1958, and I can tell you I'd rather have today's healthcare at today's prices than 1958 healthcare at 1958 prices.
Here in the middle.
What can we do to try to contain some of the extreme college tuition prices? Right now it's making it so difficult for younger people to pay for their college debt when they get out. Cars they can't buy, homes they can't buy, difficulty to even get married. So they're going to be in debt for a long time. What can we do to help contain some of those extreme college tuition costs?
It's a great question, and there are really two sectors where we could have dramatic productivity improvements relative to where we are now. One is healthcare, and the other is education. And since I work in education, I talk about healthcare. But I'll try to answer your question. Higher ed is a really broad brush. If you are borrowing money to go to an elite university, getting a meaningful degree from that university, it's an incredible private return on your investment. But a lot of student debt is being built up at places that don't look like the model that I just described. So going back to what I was saying in healthcare about information, we need to have more information available to students, whether they're very young people going to college or people who are older and in the workforce and going back to school, saying, at this school, here are the prospects of graduates. So over a long period of time, people went into this industry, this pay range, this industry, and so on. I think that information would be helpful. We also need to work more with academic leaders to get their costs down. We have this view in public policy that this is all about student loans. And I still remember when the Clinton administration was there, I gave a talk in Washington, and I said, you know, the supply of seats at Columbia is fixed. And so if you increase the ability and willingness to pay for those seats, again, I can look at your face, economics was your favorite subject. So if the supply curve looks like this, and the demand curve does this, price goes up. And so it's not a surprise. We really need to challenge academic leaders to get their costs down, because there's really no reason for this, particularly in a world where technology is offering huge cost reduction potential.
Right here.
I'm curious. So When we talk about emerging economies, when we talk about a lot of countries in Europe, we talk about the great need for structural reforms. So they need structural reforms. And I think that when we talk about the U.S., we don't say to ourselves, oh, well, we just need to implement these structural reforms. But it seems like that's kind of what we're getting at, what you're getting at in this.
It is, but I think we need to call it something else. So going back to the question that was asked before about communication, when I talk about Social Security and Medicare to general audiences, I don't call it a structural reform. I don't even use the budget word. I talk about modernization. So these are programs that were designed in a different age with markets that are way out of fashion by the standards of today. If we were starting a Social Security system today and a Medicare system today, it wouldn't look the same. And people nod their heads with that yeah, we need a different system. And maybe we need a higher minimum benefit than we have under current law, because nobody should work their whole life full time and be poor when they're old. That's a simple thing to say, and we can do that. And the way we're going to pay for that is slow the rate of growth of benefits for everybody else. I think when you put it like that, it sounds different. So I think structural reform sounds like a root canal or eating your spinach or something like that. But if you talk about how about an economy that's more future-oriented, how about a system that's more modern and useful for you, I think that's a better way to talk about it.
That makes sense. I guess my question is, when it comes to those types of modernizations or whatever we want to refer to them as, what are the top five you would see, kind of in an order of importance that we should really be focused on in order to bring the U.S. to where we can grow at 3% or more?
Well, I would put three right at the very top, and the first two relate to fiscal policy, and one is tax reform. So to tell you why I think that, if you had a textbook tax reform, a perfect tax reform, you might be able to get as much as a full percentage point of GDP extra. That's a big number in an economy growing at 2%. If you did a good tax reform, I would put Governor Bush's in that category, I think you get 0.5% of GDP per year. That's very, very big. I don't know of any other policy that comes close. The second would be entitlements. We have to look at these programs. And the reasons are two. One, they're going to require tax increases that are so large, they'll kill the prospects of growth for our children and grandchildren, and or they'll crowd out everything else. You know, we're on track to be a nation of old age benefits and interest payments. That is not a healthy nation. A healthy nation is about defense, education, research, investment. You know, we have to decide, do we want to be about the future or the past? And making these kind of structural changes can be done in ways that don't hurt people who are current beneficiaries, and frankly, will never hurt low-income people. The third area I'd put is regulation. We just don't think enough about it. We tend to think about regulation as fixing a problem rather than stepping back and saying, okay, is that the most efficient way to do it? Economists are usually the skunk at a party. We talk about cost-benefit analysis. Is this the best way? I think we need a lot more of that in government.
Over there.
You haven't mentioned income inequality yet, which is a pretty popular topic for folks like you. Wondering if you think it's a drag, if you believe it, first of all, is it a problem? Is it a drag on the growth rate? And what would you do about it?
Well, it's a great question. I wrote an essay on Piketty's book that's in the National Tax Journal. It's the long form version of the answer that I'm about to give you. But let me start with a question for all of you. What if I told you that I could produce 50 new Bill Gateses and Steve Jobs? Would you like them? How many of you would like them if I could produce them? All right, most of you. You understand, do you not, that if I could produce 50 more Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, I probably would have an even more unequal distribution of income. Yet I expect it doesn't trouble you, because you're thinking these are people whose entrepreneurship created ideas that are very, very important, and I think you'd be right. And to me, inequality is about two things as a political debate. One, I don't spend a lot of time worrying about how rich some people are, as long as they fit the mold that I just said, more Bill Gates or Steve Jobs. Getting rich by rent seeking is another matter entirely. And I think historically in this country, people have assumed, and I think generally rightly so, that people who are at the top of the income and wealth distribution got there by work and talent. And that is true for most, but not all. The bigger problem of income inequality, it strikes to me, is about the bottom. And here there's been a discussion recently from a study that Bill Gale and co-authors did at Brookings, that if you're reaching for the bottle of redistribution, you're reaching for the wrong bottle. If we raised marginal tax rates to 50% at the top, which would be well beyond what people think is possible, we might generate $100 billion a year. It's not chump change, but won't do anything to materially change living standards. If we really want to change living standards, we've got to start investing in people again. And that means education, that means training, that means actual support for work, and that's a serious agenda. And I think this discussion is intertwined with the discussion we were just having about entitlements. If you ask yourself, well, why as a nation are we not spending on those things? Well, it's because we can't. It's not about the tax rates on the rich, it's about the overpromises we've made in some areas. So to me, it's not income inequality that's the problem. It's a group of people who don't have the skills to succeed in the modern economy. I say bring on more Bill Gates and bring on more Steve Jobs, but I really am worried about the bottom.
In the third row, please.
My question goes to financial engineering and your competitive situation. I assume you're familiar with the story of Brooksley Bourne and the CFTC and the fact that AIG's $85 billion of derivatives were all contracted for in the UK to avoid US right. regulation. I love the idea of lack of regulation than the real world economy, making cars, doing things. Is there a way to regulate the financial engineering end of it so every wild derivative isn't traded and that is regulated by Dodd-Frank, but the real economy is robust?
There is. I think part of the problem we had in the AIG case is probably a need for more activity-based regulation. AIG did not get into trouble from insurance, despite what you read about in the press. It got in trouble for the reasons that you said. And I think there are ways in short-term finance to use haircut regulation to mimic the kind of regulation we have on banks. So to be specific, the Fed has that authority right now. It just isn't using it. So it could, in short-term lending, regulate the size of haircuts. That would be a way of slowing down or increasing the desirability of short-term financing transactions. So there's lots that we could do. We just weren't doing it, and we didn't need Dodd-Frank to do it. I fear that what Dodd-Frank's ethos is about trying to make us, quote, safer by cutting down a lot of this. Well, a lot of the use of derivatives is actually very positive. It's for hedging and other things that many real companies, many insurance companies do, and the baby's being thrown out with the bathwater. So yes, we definitely need regulation, but as I said, the theory of it ought to be simple at the front end, ambiguous at the back end. What we got from Dodd-Frank was the other way around, this ambiguity at the front end and thou shalt nots at the back end.
Over there in the back.
So on that point, is there any part of Dodd-Frank you'd actually retain, knowing what you know about it?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think the rules about exchange trading, derivatives, which are good government stuff that had been in the drawers of all the good government staffers for a long time, sure. But in general, I think of Dodd-Frank like the game show Jeopardy. If it's the answer, what was the question? So if you look at the actual crisis, right, housing was pretty big in the crisis. It's not really in Dodd-Frank, other than qualifying mortgage rules. The Volcker Rule, well, banks didn't get into trouble for that reason. Banks actually got into trouble for the oldest fashioned reason possible. They held dodgy stuff. I mean, that's classic in banking. So Dodd-Frank was just answering a question that didn't even happen, as opposed to stepping back and saying, okay, what did we go through? If it was about run, risk, and regulation, if you accept my categories, have we dealt with that? Is a run less likely? Are we mispricing risks? And is regulation creating the right incentive? So I just think we missed an opportunity. So yeah, there's some stuff in there, but there's not a lot. And here's the bad part. It's very hard to amend that. The only thing that's happened recently was a technical clarification in the Collins Amendment about insurance. But you know, generally, it's really hard to reopen Dodd-Frank, even on technical issues, because it's so politicized. So I worry this is the law for some time.
One here in the second row, please.
So I'm curious your take a lot on the, when we talk about the demand side of things, we've seen a real rise in the sharing economy as opposed to the purchasing economy. Mm-hmm. What's your take on the impact of the sharing economy?
I think it's great. It has unleashed assets that were dormant. And so whether it's your car in Uber or Lyft, or whether it's your apartment in Airbnb, you now as an individual have the ability to monetize the use of assets that you didn't have before. Now, whenever you have innovation, you always have incumbents who are fearful of innovation. So I live in New York, which is a highly regulated city in transportation, so taxi medallions were well over $1 million. They've come down a lot in value, so people are gonna be upset. But I think for consumers, just what regulation's supposed to be protecting, not incumbents, these are all good news. I just think it's gonna change our economy. Now, where I get off the train a little bit from the techno-optimists in the Valley is their view is this will be the solution to income inequality. I'm not gonna go that far. But I do think it liberalizes a lot of capital from a lot of average people, and that's a huge, huge win.
Front row here, we had a question.
You've put a lot of emphasis on tax reform, but tax reform is famously very difficult to do because of all of the very powerful vested interests involved, especially today with all of the money flowing through the political system. You've worked at the highest levels of policymaking in the federal government. Do you have any suggestion? What you've talked about is what the nature of the tax reform should be, but you haven't talked at all about how you might go about doing that, which seems to me is the really difficult problem.
Well, it's a great question. Tax reform, when somebody talks to you about 0.5% of GDP extra, numbers like that are just huge. That's like my telling you there are a bunch of $100 bills on the floor. Now, when you studied economics, again, your favorite course in college, I'm sure the professor told you there are no $100 bills on the floor because somebody would have picked them up, the professor, if nothing else. So what is it about tax reform? Well, if you look at tax reforms that work, they tend to involve a cocktail that's a little unusual in policy. One is they're big, not small. And that's important because when you tackle something small, you create obvious winners and losers. So to be concrete, there are a lot of people on both sides of the aisle interested in corporate tax reform. Well, I don't think that's going to happen, and here's why. If you use the scorekeeping that official scorekeepers do to cut the corporate rate to anything meaningful, would require so much base broadening that most business people are going to say, I don't want that. So it's not going to happen. If you broaden the tax reform discussion and make it about everything at once, there's a lot of horse trading that goes on. So if you look not only at the 86 Act, but Bush's acts in 2001, 2003 involved enormous amount of horse trading. The second thing is you've got to have leadership. And the president has to want tax reform. It doesn't come from the Congress organically. The reason I'm optimistic it can happen is if now that Paul Ryan is Speaker of the House, nobody's a bigger tax and budget wonk in the Congress than Paul Ryan. And if we had a president that were concerned about this, I absolutely think tax reform can happen. I frankly think tax reform will happen if Mrs. Clinton's president. I think it'll be different, but I think the pressures are just that great. This is one you really will see, whether it's from Secretary Clinton or from one of the Republican candidates.
Over here, fourth row.
Thank you. Do you think it would be beneficial to audit the Fed?
If I understand your question, the answer is no. The Fed is audited the way most of you in the room think about auditing. So the books of the Fed, I can assure you that Michael was not able to steal vast sums from the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago. He would have been detected quickly. When the Congress talks about auditing the Fed, that's not what they mean. They're not talking about the accounts. You're talking about micromanaging Fed decisions. I think that's a decidedly bad idea. The Fed's a technocratic institution. Monetary policy should be independent. Members of Congress, of course, have the right to question the Fed, and the Fed chair has to be available at their beck and call to do so, and that's as it should be. But I think auditing the Fed misses the point. Having said that, you know, I think members of Congress are on to something. They just didn't do it in the right way. So what's some of the things they're on to? If you ask yourself, what's an essential characteristic of a high reliability organization, which I think we would aspire the Fed to be, high reliability organizations try to avoid groupthink. So examples, even in nuclear power, where tail risk matters, you try to create the avoidance of groupthink. The Fed reformers, I think, if anything, are trying to push toward, on the one hand, some people are trying to centralize authority in Washington, which is anti that notion, or others would have just random rifle shot comments from various members of the FOMC. I think we need to rethink that. We also, I think, need to rethink terms. So Federal Reserve governors have 14-year terms, and the design of the Federal Reserve Act is to make sure that the president doesn't control the Federal Reserve Board. Well, the president does control the Federal Reserve Board because most people stay very short period of time. And if you were president in office for a short period of time, that's an issue. So I think we need to look at the structure of the Fed, but I think auditing the Fed sounds like a really bad idea.
In the back.
First off, thank you.
Sure.
My question is with regard to the national debt, you know, $18 trillion, probably closer to 30 if you include intergovernment debt. To what degree has that possibly limited the Fed's ability to normalize interest rates, as well as when does it become a threat to our world reserve currency status and the full faith and credit of the United States?
It's a great question. I don't think it actually is top of mind for the Fed, although people in the government should be thinking about it. We're pegging interest rates at very low levels. And while many of you have probably been terming out debt, the Treasury has done the opposite, shortening the maturity of debt. So it's ready to be whipsawed whenever rates rise. But I don't think that's top of mind for the Fed. It will be a budget outcome. The problem is the institutions we have for the budget were developed in a world that we don't live in. So if you were to look from the American Revolution to the late 1960s or about 1970, debt would be entirely a story about war and peace. So you built up debt in war, you paid it down in peace. So if you look at any industrial economy, your debt to GDP ratio looks like a mountain range, goes up and down. After 1970, it more or less goes straight up. And the institutions that were about temporary war financing were not designed for an entitlement economy. And that's what's driving the dynamics of debt. So it's not just the size of debt that people focus on, but we've really got to change our institutions and the way Congress makes decisions. Because we, long before we, quote, lose our reserve currency, we still run the risk of hollowing out the rest of government. We won't be able to fund national defense at the level most Americans want, or education, or research, because we're spending too much. So I think that's really the issue. I think currently the public sees the debt numbers as so big they're just not believable. I think to connect the dots, we have to talk about what we're going to have to give up if we keep going down that road.
We have another one. Fourth row.
Are you concerned about some of the recent M&A activity, especially in the healthcare space, and do you believe in the theory of crony capitalism?
Those are two different questions. I definitely think crony capitalism is a problem. I think it is now encouraged by regulation. When you have a larger state, a larger regulatory state, you just create enormous opportunities for business people to invest in that as an activity. And we ought to have the smartest business people thinking about new things, not about maximizing Washington. Every time I'm on the shuttle going to Washington, I just really lament the number of business leaders I see on the plane, because they should be doing real things, not going to Washington. So crony capitalism is there. But your previous question was
M&A.
M&A. I don't see it as a competition problem, unless you know, unless you can demonstrate that. Most of the M&A is not, strictly speaking, horizontal, that you would look at in competition policy. What I worry about is that some of it in healthcare and some other industries is being driven by tax policy. So inversions and things like that are about our crazy tax code more than business people really thinking that these companies fit together in some way. It's good for their shareholders, but from the economy's perspective, I'm less sure. But I don't blame those CEOs for trying to take advantage of the tax code.
And we have time for one more question. Over here in the fourth row, please.
Thank you again. My question relates to Dodd-Frank and financial regulation. So in the wake of Dodd-Frank, how can financial regulators in the US coordinate most effectively with their counterparts in Asia and Europe to create greater cross-border harmonization?
That's a great question, and the good news is that's happening. So regulators have moved to what they call a college approach, which is people across jurisdictions coming together. At the highest level, you can think about the Financial Stability Board, but regulators, whether it's in prudential supervision, insurance, you know, are getting together much more regularly. And that's important because most important institutions are global. And so if you were to think about a resolution of a large institution, that doesn't happen in a single country. So I think that's the good news. I would just love it if those same discussions actually could filter to policymakers because they seem much more clueless. But the regulators are really doing, I think, a good job in that. So that's a good element. Didn't come from Dodd-Frank, but it is a good development nonetheless.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. Thank you very much, Professor Hubbard.
Thank you.